Welcome to Face the Facts. I am Nick Face, returning for 2017, first show of the year. Chris Millett, welcome to the house.
Good to be here, Nick. We got a lot to discuss.
We have a very big week. If you're a Patriots fan, stay right here. Keep the remote right here. Do not turn the channel. We do want to let you know, please lock your kids in their rooms. It's time for the facts to be faced.
It is. Unscripted tonight.
It's unscripted tonight. There's nothing on the table besides this water bottle. And I think that's because we're well prepared and we know what we're going to be talking about.
Exactly.
And that's the Patriots.
A lot has gone on in preparation for the Super Bowl. A lot is going to happen this weekend.
Yep.
I expect something big. As you said before the show, you can see into the future.
I can.
I, myself, can also see into the future.
I got the magic eight ball.
Something else is going to drop Saturday night, Friday night, maybe something with Goodell. Maybe Brady's dad again goes after him. Mm-hmm. Although I think Tom has quietly spoken with his dad and said, enough, you're done.
Tom Sr.
I'm the spotlight now.
He's got the gag order on him right now.
And I love how we can open up and talk about that. How Tom Brady's father is stepping in the week before the Super Bowl and telling Roger Goodell, if you go after my son one more time, then I'm going to stick it
Wouldn't
to you.
Wouldn't your dad do the same thing?
Yeah, I mean.
Mine would too.
Yeah.
If you were wrongfully accused of something,
right,
and somebody stepped in the way and was trying to hurt your career, hurt your legacy,
right,
and impact you in some sort of way,
yep,
dad, go all for it.
Exactly.
Put this guy in his place.
It's not like Roger Goodell can punish his father for anything.
Correct.
And someone had to do it. It was the elephant in the room. It's been the elephant in the room all throughout media day, today and yesterday, in preparation for the Super Bowl. And I think that little jab saying, you know what, Patriots Nation and Tom Brady Nation, we're not going to just hold back and wait for Sunday for when we win the championship. We're coming at you now. We're coming at you hot.
Yep.
And we're going to stick it up. You know what, come Sunday night.
Well, I think Tom Brady Sr. is correct.
Yep.
Roger Goodell is a lying piece of crap. Sorry, we can say that here. He is. He did it once again today. He had his press conference, his State of the NFL address that he gave.
Absolutely
and he
trash.
Once again is a piece of crap. I'm sorry.
He's a liar.
The performance that he gave today was nothing but a bunch of nonsense bull.
Yep.
First of all, the first big thing that came out was Barstool Sports, and I'm sure many of you at home here know about Barstool Sports, is an online...
Correct. Very popular, young men, teens.
Internet.
Media outlet. Yeah.
Where it's run by Dave Portnoy. He does stories about all sorts of great things. It's really, it's an up-and-coming organization that's done a really nice job, I think.
They denied their credentials.
Correct. So they are not able to be at Media Row or Radio Row, whatever you call it, for the Super Bowl.
Hey, come on. You're going to say that one media outlet can't ask Tom Brady a question. They can't ask Julian Edelman a question. What is that going to do, Roger?
Well,
what
he's doing it on purpose because this is the organization that 2 years ago when all of this nonsense came out, went to NFL headquarters and they chained themselves to the building or whatever it was.
Protested, got thrown in jail.
Called Goodell Hitler and everything. Freedom of speech.
Yep.
Freedom of speech, sorry.
I mean,
you can disagree with it all you want. It might not have been done the right way, but you can't punish somebody for that.
Right. I mean, to me, the big thing is if Roger Goodell is so scared of four Barstool employees and Barstool as a company, and he sees them as that powerful. Mm-hmm. I mean, good for Barstool for being that up and coming and that powerful.
Correct.
That they can have an effect on Roger Goodell's mind. The person who's making multi-million dollar contract.
Yep.
And he's single-handedly calling him out. If that isn't an attack on Tom Brady and the Patriots indirectly, then I don't know what it is.
The whole thing has been an attack, though. It's not like because he hates
Dave Portnoy. It's because Dave Portnoy defends Brady, and therefore Roger Goodell hates him.
Correct.
Roger Goodell is going to be ousted as the commissioner at least 2 years from now. If he's not ousted two years from now, there's going to be a big boycott, Patriots Nation, especially after we win it Sunday. I mean, and people aren't just going to like him. They don't like him now.
But here's the wonderful thing that I like about the whole Barstool Sports thing. They could have very easily been pounded rocks, come right back at Goodell and everything. They got their own TV show on Comedy Central this week.
Yeah.
talk about raising the bar.
They got the most NFL fans as an audience.
Correct.
Second to probably what, like SportsCenter or something like that. They got the best ratings all week.
Yeah.
And to deny them from the NFL, their fans aren't going to like that.
No.
Their fans are going to want to see Roger Goodell suffer and not do so well. So,
Roger, you know what's interesting about the Roger Goodell front that I noticed? It's not just New England fans that hate his guts.
Yeah.
It's everybody.
Yeah, I know on TV the other
everybody.
Day.
Everybody.
On some of the local
they all hate
the
him.
News channels, they were interviewing Texans fans, and they're saying, I know I don't like Tom Brady, but I want to see him win to stick it to Goodell.
Correct.
They don't see Tom Brady necessarily being the big bad wolf.
Yep.
They see someone who's been unjustly attacked,
yep.
and therefore they want to see him. They want to see him win because of it.
Isn't it amazing that this whole story was over 2 years ago when it came out? When the Patriots lost in the Super Bowl.
I remember 2 years
ago doing
a show.
And we're still talking about it. It's 2017.
Mm-hmm.
Over a football that might have, or could have, or probably more than likely have had some sort of impact on the game.
It was interesting. This Sunday, two Sundays ago now, Teddy Bruschi was on the AFC Championship stage.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I remember Teddy Bruschi coming out about six months, a year ago, and defending Tom Brady, his former teammate, on live TV on ESPN.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be very interesting to see if he was on the stage this Sunday, mm-hmm. and we won it. And he said a few words on behalf of Tom Brady.
Well,
I think that would be a very emotional and also a very powerful thing for him to do.
He will be on the stage. He will be on the stage. I know that 100%. They will make sure that Bruschi's there.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for Bruschi being a part with ESPN and all that, I think the Patriots would never have any sort of light on that network outside of negativity.
Yeah.
They wouldn't.
Because ESPN lies.
I mean, I don't watch ESPN. I've boycotted them. The only way I'd watch ESPN it was if the game really was on there.
Right.
But I will not watch their sports news. I won't. I won't watch any of their sports shows. I won't watch FSN's disputed show.
Uh-huh.
I won't watch any of it. I'll stick to Comcast or NESN or
whatever
local news station to cover the news.
I mean, NFL Network even is doing a good job this week.
So NFL Network has trashed the Patriots, too.
Yeah.
They all do.
It's...
And here's another
thing that I
always do. The
Patriots aren't
going
to get fair coverage unless it's a Boston-based
organization. I always do this, and maybe people should take up this. If the game is on, and if it's on like CBS or NBC or anything, all you got to do is mute the sound on the TV and throw the radio on.
That's true.
Listen to you. I mean, I understand Zolak and Bob Saucier.
But it's a lot better than sometimes than Chris Collinsworth
or Collinsworth.
Else. Who's it going to be? Joe Buck has the game, I think.
I don't mind that. I give Joe Buck credit
he's
for football.
He's a baseball voice, though. He's a World Series baseball voice to me. I remember, I'd rather have Chris Collinsworth do the game. Mm-hmm. Joe Buck is baseball. That's why I don't like when these organizations...
They fight over it.
No, it's like they're just assigning the best games to the same two guys.
Right.
Have two guys specialize in one sport. Don't you think the content would be better that way because you know
more
about
one? You mean
like
having like Teddy Bruschi a part of a broadcast?
Right.
Or
I just want
having...
the same two announcers for the sport or the same team all year round.
Yeah, it would make sense. It would. But
I don't want... Yeah.
TV networks don't make sense.
Contracts and all that
Contracts
stuff.
Contracts and money get into it a lot of the times. So that's our stance on a little bit of the opening ceremonies and all with the Super Bowl. There's a lot of things that are happening. We do know, in case, I don't know how any of you wouldn't, but the Patriots are playing in Super Bowl 51.
Against the Atlanta Falcons.
It should be an excellent game. We know Tom Brady's coming off a great performance in the Pittsburgh game. Let's look at that game first, then we'll get to previewing the Super
game.
Let's look at the Pittsburgh game first, because we never really broke down that game there.
I was at that game.
I was at the Texans game. Before we get to the Pittsburgh, I think, and I'm just going to make a bold prediction here and bold statement, I think the game against Houston is going to be the Patriots' toughest competition here.
Huh.
I don't think there's going to be much competition here.
It's going to just a rollover.
I think Houston's going to give what it, I think the Houston game was the biggest run for the money. If they had had a quarterback.
And that's surprising because Bill O'Brien said before the game, before the postseason, how he's just looking to score one touchdown.
Right.
And for a coach to come out and admit that his team is that weak.
Yep.
That's so sad.
But I don't think it's
that
him.
That is so sad.
It's not him. That's him having no confidence with his quarterback
play. I know, but isn't that so sad for your own head coach to give up on your
squad?
That's
a Belichick difference versus another coach.
Right.
And O'Brien should know better because he was here under that coaching staff.
Pittsburgh 2 weeks ago in the AFC game can't even score a touchdown. Yep. My God. They won a game without scoring a touchdown, which was unheard of. Yep. All field goals. And then 2 weeks ago, they're losing, because they can't score. You're not going to be a successful team without scoring a touchdown.
No, you're
right. And the fact that, in your opinion, Atlanta's going to be weaker than that, that's surprising.
Atlanta's going to be weaker than Pittsburgh.
No.
I'm sorry.
Matt Ryan is so good. Julio Jones and his supporting cast is far better, I believe, than Houston and Pittsburgh combined.
You want to know why I feel that way? Because I'd love to tell you why I feel this way.
Go ahead. Tell the audience at home why.
You have a running back in Le'Veon Bell,
right?
Who, in
but
my
he
eyes,
shut him down.
I get that.
Yeah.
But he's more talented and better than Devontae Freeman. Now, that's number one.
Okay.
Julio Jones is a boom or bust receiver.
Okay.
The Patriots are always able to shut down the number one receiver.
Their best player.
In their defense.
Correct. Yeah.
If you shut down Julio Jones, you're going to have to use the secondary guys that are a part of Atlanta. Are the Atlanta secondary players better than Pittsburgh's? Yes, I will give them that for a credit right there. But the Patriots also do not lose to opponents when there's a high-scoring match. The Patriots only lose ball games when the defense is tested. So, for instance, when you have Denver, that game against Denver when it was low-scoring, that was a good defense. Same against the Houston Texans, great defense. It's never offense for offense. Never. Because Brady will come out and deliver and lead the team to the victory.
I saw a stat the other night that, you know, as well, the past Super Bowls that the Patriots have been in since 2001 have all been decided by 3 or 4 points.
And that's why the point spread right now is at 3 points.
Correct. Because the Patriots just haven't proven. Even when they've won, it's been by 3 or 3. And
that's why it's there.
However, even when they've run up the score into the 28, 31, that area, they've still been able to catch up to them.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a testament to, when I look at that, I see a weak defense, and maybe an inexperienced defense that can't mentally prepare themselves and mentally stabilize themselves in the high-pressure situation.
For the Patriots, you think?
Yes. If Tom Brady is so good, then the defense should be able to do their job as well and stabilize and diminish the score.
Correct. I will tell you this. This Patriots team is more talented than the 2014
team. Oh, I agree. They've grown tremendously.
This team
visible.
Has probably 2 or 3 years now grown as a defensive unit. I think Matt Patricia is a more knowledgeable coach on what he can call for certain plays as well.
Yeah.
I'm usually pretty good and pretty. I can usually predict a lot of the scores, and that's just because of watching the game, seeing what the game plan is, seeing what can get done.
Yep.
I'm going to stick to my guns and say it's going to be 38-14. That's my score.
Okay.
All right. I know it's high scoring. I do agree with the 3 points, but it's usually always is competition when the Patriots play. It's the big stage, it's nerves, it's tension, it's all that jazz. This one is personal this year. It's a personal match.
Yep.
It is bulletin board material number one for the Patriots. The focus still remains on proving the doubters, proving the league, raising that trophy, and Brady wants number 5.
Correct.
He wants to have 5. It'll cement
him. Wants one for the thumb.
Cements him as no more questions about it, the greatest quarterback of all time.
And after, will he retire?
We'll what do you think
that.
About that?
We'll get to that. We all know what I think about that. I've told people at home that I think if he wins and he goes out on that high note of a Super Bowl, having one for each of his fingers, that would just, I think, set him apart. And I think it's a personal decision for him. But above all, that's one of the, I don't want to say cockiest moves that he could do, but kind of saying, you know what, guys, I'm all set. I did my job. I prove to you what I can do. I don't need to prove anything else.
Would he do that?
Would he do that? I mean, I don't know Tom Brady as a person or character, or what his character is, to the extent that maybe his family does. However, I think, yeah. I would rather Super Bowl championship this year and to remember Tom Brady from coming back from the persecution that he received to be a champion. That kind of persecutor mentality that he was put under by Goodell, and then him just saying, you know what, I'm going to block it out and just show you what I am.
Right.
It's the same mentality that he's had to come back from when he was drafted in the sixth round. And he said, and he looked into Robert Kraft's eyes and said, I'm going to prove to you that I was the best decision you ever made. It's a no-brainer.
Well, we do know that Tom Brady, throughout the years, has been able to prove all the doubters wrong.
Yeah.
If somebody doubts him on anything, he just goes out and proves it wrong. I don't see why this isn't any different for this weekend coming up. I don't. I want to say that over all the Super Bowls that they've been to, and it dates back from 2002 on, and I've been thinking about this a lot, over how confident I was with the Patriots going into each game. I always thought the Giants, when they were playing them, were shaky. Yeah. I always thought that because it was hit or miss. I'm not playing that card at all right now.
It's almost like we're guaranteeing ourselves something. It's like, okay, yeah, when's Sunday going to come? When's Monday going to come when I can go down
and
to Olympia Sports
and
get my T-shirt?
This hat's old. This hat is
2 years old?
This is 2 years old, and it's kind of funny. I found this hat this week,
yeah,
and it was sitting under something else, and I pulled it out and I looked at it, and I said, look at this. I go, that was the 49,
yep.
Super Bowl 49.
Yep.
I need 51. The question will be white or be a different color?
I know. I honestly wish that they would change the colors.
We are just embedded in such a time right now where we are so spoiled rotten.
Yeah.
I'm spoiled rotten. I'll say it right here.
Yep.
If we don't win a championship in 2 years, I'm going to cry. Myself to sleep.
The show will be canceled for another 2 years.
Yep.
I know, but honestly, I wish that they would change the colors off. I'd like a red hat or even a red shirt.
I mean, it gets dirty. Cool. That's the only point. I haven't worn it that much. I'm wearing it this week just for a good omen sort of thing. And I think
But like, they always go gray or white, and it's like, they all look the same.
Right.
So.
Maybe I'll go back and wear the other ones this week and kind of put a little history
retro.
On it. I got all of the ones that they've been there. So my least favorite one is when they had a brown one. That was from, I think, the 2004 Super Bowl.
That. Yeah.
Oh, that was nasty.
Yeah.
It was just nasty colors because they were in the desert or something.
The Red Sox ones are always cool.
The Red Sox ones are cool.
But enough of our spoiled apparel.
I need a new sweatshirt too, but never mind. Go ahead.
No, I mean, you're right. The level of confidence is unlike anything I've ever had before a sporting event.
Right.
I remember watching Game 6 and Game 7s. You're always shaky about that. But this one, when it comes down to just one, there's so much level of confidence. And I think that this is coming from because, really, this is Tom Brady's 15th week. He's still in the regular season. His arm is still in the regular season. He's fresher than anyone else out there.
Yep.
And his best games have always come. Go back and look at the books. Have always come in the 14th or 15th week of his regular season of his career.
Yep.
It's a no-brainer.
Yep.
It's almost as if they thought they were doing Tom Brady a disservice when really they were putting him a step ahead. And if he got to this point, that he would just demolish.
I just think that sometimes there's omens. Like 2013's Red Sox championship.
Yeah.
That was an omen.
That was awesome. That was Boston Strong.
Boston Strong all the way.
That was Let's Go, baby.
That team
Johnny Gomes.
Rallied around itself. There was nobody that was going to stop them.
Right.
That was the Red Sox season from that moment on.
And we have respect for the Chicago Cubs this year as well.
Yeah, of course.
Bringing in Lester and kind of building that organization. It was the same kind of 04.
I didn't mind Chicago winning that this year.
They're a great team.
That was a great World Series this year.
That was a classic win.
This right now just seems to me that there's somebody from above, no matter, or something going on, that just tells me that Roger Goodell, you're going to pay for this. You're going to pay really bad for it. And you know what? You're going to even have to hand the MVP trophy to Tom Brady himself. I feel good about it right now.
What if I told you this? We win, and I was thinking about this the other day. Would you be as mad if they purposely, or maybe if another player deserves it, Tom Brady does not get the MVP? Does that change the
Depends on how he plays.
Dynamic. No, I'm saying if someone else, I guess, deserved it, or maybe he has a pretty good performance and you just hand it to kind of someone else who played a key role.
I'd be okay with that.
Like a Julian Edelman or like a Hogan who played a great game.
I'd be okay with that.
I think, honestly, that diminishes the dynamic because we want to see Brady win.
Yeah, we do.
We don't want to see like kind of like the Patriots win, although we do.
Yep.
We really want to see Tom Brady win and we want to see Roger Goodell and Tom Brady right there. So if Tom Brady is still on the floor dancing with his teammates and Julian Edelman, or maybe even Matt Ryan has a hell of a game and they give him the MVP of the game.
Yeah.
Does that diminish stuff for us?
So there's a couple ways to answer that question. I would say no. It doesn't matter to me how the game is won because it, in my eyes,
a banner's a banner.
With the Super Bowl, a win is a win from that.
Yeah.
You win it as a team. So no matter what, if Tom Brady, say, doesn't have that great of a game, but yet they still pull it out and win, Brady still has 5 Super Bowl rings. Still has it. You can still stick it to the commissioner because it's a Patriots organizational thing. It's not just about the I person in Tom Brady.
And that's why I think Tom Brady's been so great because he's been selfless.
And now I will tell you this. If they do happen to lose, I don't think that's going to happen, but we can't predict everything. Yep. If they do lose, the same motivation and the same mentality will apply for next season.
Right.
It's still public enemy number
one.
I haven't even thought about that.
It's
the commissioner.
At all. I haven't even thought about that.
They want to get that ball. They want to get that trophy no matter what.
Yeah.
Brady will not step away from this game
until
he has that
more.
5. Yeah. Absolutely won't.
That's why I think he might do it this year.
So if he does win it, Chris, your point isn't so crazy, but I think that point only can be justified if he was in his 40s. He's right now 39. I get it's close, but he still has years. He still has a good amount of time left in him. It's just how I feel. You can be different with it. I kind of like it when people are different.
Yeah.
I mean, I allow you on here, so I mean, you are different. We're all in our own world.
We got a lot of different viewers at home.
Including my view on David Ortiz. I had to get that line in there, too. But I do think that there is a lot to like about the chances right now for the Patriots, and I feel pretty confident.
When's the parade? We should probably be
Wednesday.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, sorry, we have a busy day at work, so
I know.
We're not allowed
we had
to
some
go.
Past employees go to that. We had some past employees go to that, and they got on TV with their Barstool signs.
They did.
Yes, they did. That was awesome.
What else can we look at from this Super Bowl? What else do we need to prepare our audience at home for?
Who's the halftime show? Do you know?
The halftime show. That is a great question. Oh, it's Lady Gaga.
No.
Lady Gaga.
All the guys will be going down.
Quick. Done.
Having another drink, getting their new plate of nachos. But I'll pass on that.
I'm passing on the Gaga.
Yeah, I'll be going to get some food during that.
I don't need to listen to that.
What song has she come out with the past 2 years?
Oh, God knows.
Like,
she'll probably
sing,
dress like a pizza or something.
She's going to sing Bad Romance from like 10 years ago.
She'll dress like a thing of nachos.
And all the people,
where's the dip? Yeah. And that's her.
And all the people at home, oh, my God, this is great.
Yep.
This is great.
Last year I liked. That was when they had Coldplay.
Yeah.
And they had Bruno Mars and some other people
like
in
Beyonce,
there. It was okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was okay. I didn't mind that. I want to look at the whole thing with Robert Kraft here for a second.
Okay.
How much of an influence an owner has on a team. Now, here's a guy that got the Patriots in 1993, bought the team, and they were originally supposed to move to Hartford, Connecticut. That's where the Patriots were going to be.
Really?
He bought this team when they were on the mist of existence, basically. They almost were gone for the most part. Bought into the team, threw some money into it. They were originally at the old Foxborough Stadium back in the day. Then moved the team over to the beautiful facility at Gillette Stadium.
Now he's holding concerts and everything and making a buck a night.
My question to you, though, here is how important can an owner or ownership group be to a sports organization or a sports team?
Financially, they're a great impact.
However, you need to have an owner
who is invested in the sport.
Okay, that was my question.
And
you,
not just solely and primarily concerned about what their pocketbook and paycheck looks like at the end.
Okay.
I believe.
Jeremy Jacobs.
Okay, go ahead. That's why he's failed so much. Just Jeremy Jacobs. It seems like he's always up there with his little binoculars and getting more popcorn. He's a guy that's not invested fully.
Correct.
You see Robert Kraft constant. I remember I was at the game for the divisional round, and he's high-fiving people, telling Edelman how he's going to have a great game.
Every game's an event for him.
Going down to each player and looking them in the eye.
Yep.
I mean, Tom Brady said when he was drafted, Robert Kraft knew him before Tom Brady knew who Robert Kraft was.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert Kraft had his number, had his kind of who he was all about before Tom Brady did.
Yep.
So Robert Kraft is a great example of how, and I've always been a fan of this, the more you love the game, and we love Boston sports, we love the game.
Sure.
The reason you become successful at something, although you certainly need to have a giant savings account, or however you want to call that, your assets need to be very, very look good. I'll just say that. You need to have a lot of money. You need to be invested, because if you don't know what you're doing, bye-bye. And your team will suffer that. Your region will suffer that. And they don't
think
the Patriots as being just Belichick and Brady. They also see Kraft above them all. Them in that situation.
Do you think that that's one of the reasons why so many sports organizations and teams fail?
Yes, of course. Okay. Of course. That's staring everyone in the face.
Right.
That's just blatant. I mean, we see it even local sports, college sports. If the college doesn't have the right AD, athletic director, if people don't know at home, it stands for, and they're not putting their time and energy in the right places and places that need work, the college is going to suffer.
Right.
An organization and team is built from the top down and certainly not from the players up. You need to have the right people in the right leadership positions, and then you build your small little guys, and you have your little tiny army guys go out. But you need someone at the top.
Does the Kraft family, we'll put it as the family because of Jonathan and everything, is he the greatest sports owner right now in sports?
I don't know. I mean, like...
How about for football?
For, like, four rings. Like, do you measure
football.
That?
Football.
Do you measure... Okay, if I'm going to measure ownership, I'm not just going to measure championships. I'm also going to look at where the organization started when they bought the team and where it is now.
Starting from the bottom, now we're here.
Yeah, legit. That's why he has a legitimate case that he is the greatest.
Mm-hmm.
You said Jeremy Jacobs. You have the Dallas Cowboys name attached to him, but he is certainly not the reason that organization...
Oh, Jerry Jones, you mean.
Jeremy Jacobs.
That's the Boston Bruins guy.
Jerry Jones. Excuse me.
He's a piece of work.
Yeah. The Bruins, we could have another... I will rip that front office.
That's brutal.
That's almost
absolute garbage.
That is almost as worse as the Cleveland Browns front office. They are just... I mean, like, and I'm honestly not a fan of old players stepping into... That's what I don't like. Cam Neely.
Yeah.
Like, you can know the game and know how it operates as a player and contracts and this. But from an organizational level and how it needs to run as a business, honestly, these guys don't know a lot.
No.
Like someone like a Sam Kennedy,
yep.
who's the real deal and knows how to promote and kind of run Fenway Park as a business.
Yep.
And he honestly was never a major league baseball.
Oh, you mean without Larry Lucchino?
Yeah.
Funny.
Sam Kennedy might be in the next Theo Epstein, and you might see him be a GM or operations guy.
Yeah.
He's definitely more of a business guy. We're talking Sam Kennedy, Fenway Park, Boston Red Sox, kind of director of development, vice president, whatever his kind of.
He takes care of that financial side of things. Yeah. Then you got Dombrowski, who does the general manager side of stuff.
But Sam Kennedy's a genius when it comes to that. The events that he's bringing into Fenway Park, which is awesome.
Yep.
But I think this Sunday is going to be a hell of a game.
Yep.
In
case some of you just tuned in late, we were asking the question of how important is the influence of a really great owner of a sports team? We were talking about Robert Kraft and how... Just amazing it's been since he got the team in 1993 to get them to this stage.
Yep.
I mean, they've only missed the playoffs twice since 2001. 2002 and 2008. Just absolutely astounding. Tom Brady's missed the playoffs once in his career. Once.
That's unheard of in professional sports.
Because 2008 he was hurt. That was the Matt Castle year.
Unheard of in professional sports.
Just unheard of. So I don't want to hear any more debate about greatest of all time. It's as I said to the kids this week, as my joke.
I wish there could be an award. Like
Tom Brady's...
He takes the NFL to court on like trial that he is the greatest of all time.
You know what he can get?
And we have a jury.
Hey, I got a great idea for this. I'm a Donald Trump guy. You're a Donald Trump guy. Very simple. Tom Brady will be have the Presidential Medal of Freedom after this is all done. I'm totally convinced. That'll be the biggest thing that ever happened.
No, but I don't even care. Whatever. I mean, like apparently, Donald Trump and Robert Kraft and Tom Brady are kind of like this.
How do politics fall into the Super Bowl here? We haven't asked that.
That's another show. That's another show. I just need Tom Brady to get bestowed an award. And I want
the Donald Trump Award.
I want it hanging.
You're fired.
I just want like the greatest of all time. No, I want it coming from the NFL. I don't want it coming from Washington. Yeah. I don't want it coming from the NFL. I want Roger Goodell to sign it.
Can we have Trump powers on this?
I want it framed at Patriots Place. So people can go as like a shrine, a basilica, and just kneel down. And I want a statue of Tom Brady right there.
How about we give call it Blank You Goodell?
Yep.
A Blank You Goodell statue.
That's the exhibit. Yep. And it's Brady like dropping back for a pass or something like that. And it's that piece of writing. I think that could sell. I'd buy $50. You can go and take a picture.
I'd buy one of them.
That'd be amazing.
I'd put it on my front lawn.
This Sunday should be very interesting, folks.
It should be very interesting.
Another Super Bowl, another chance that New England and Boston gets to take one home. And hopefully next week we can go into the parade. We'll cancel work. All the workers go in, take the day off.
National holiday for everybody.
Yep.
Don't worry. Donald Trump's in power. It will happen now. It'll happen.
I wonder if he's going to be at the game.
Of course he is.
He's going to go to the game?
Of course he is. He's got to root on his buddies.
Yeah. That'd be interesting if he was Donald Trump repping a Tom Brady jersey. That'd be funny.
It would be hysterical.
But thank you for tuning in tonight,
Absolutely.
Folks.
Absolutely.
I'll let the boss man take over.
That's right. We hope everybody enjoys the Super Bowl for Sunday. We wish the Patriots good luck. And we will hopefully be able to see you soon to break down all the game action from the lovely Super Bowl. Hopefully next time you see us, we'll see the Super Bowl champions being the New England Patriots for this Super Bowl 51. I'm Nick Face. We will see you again next time on Face the Facts. Good night.
Go Pats.